Well, good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending where you're joining us from today. Welcome to Engineering for Change, or E4C for short. Today, we're very pleased to bring you the latest in our 2016 webinar series on the topic of design, testing, and implementation of a life-saving product. My name is Yana Aranda, and I'm the Director of Programs at E4C. I'll be the moderator for today's webinar. All right, I'd like to take a moment now to tell you a bit more about today's webinar. According to the World Health Organization, 29% of all deaths of children between the ages of 1 and 5 are vaccine preventable, and 15% of all deaths are due to pneumonia. These deaths are especially prevalent in resource-constrained environments. Intellectual Ventures has responded to both challenges with what they do best, research and development and invention of life-saving products. So we've invited Dr. Stephen Harston, inventor at Intellectual Ventures, to share insights about the design of groundbreaking medical devices and methods to innovate effectively. Welcome, and thank you for joining us today. Before we get rolling, I'd also like to thank the E4C webinar series team. If anybody out there has questions about the series or would like to make a recommendation for future topics and speakers, we invite you to contact the team via the email address visible on the slide. The webinar you are participating in today is part of E4C's professional development offerings. Information on upcoming installments in the series, as well as archive videos of past presentations, can be found on the E4C webinars webpage. If you're following us on Twitter today, I'd also like to invite you to join the conversation with our dedicated hashtag, #E4CWebinars. Before we move on to our presenter, I'd like to tell you a bit more about E4C and who we are. E4C is a knowledge exchange platform and global community of over 1 million engineers, designers, development practitioners, and social scientists leveraging technology to solve quality of life challenges faced by underserved communities. These can include access to clean water and sanitation, sustainable energy solutions, improved agriculture, and more. We invite you to join E4C by becoming a member. E4C membership provides cost-free access to relevant and current news, professional development resources, including opportunities such as jobs and fellowships, and a growing database of hundreds of poverty alleviating products in our solutions library, including products from Intellectual Ventures. E4C members enjoy a unique user experience based on their site behavior and engagement. Essentially, the more you interact with our site, the better we will be able to serve you resources aligned to your interests. We invite you to join our passionate global community and contribute to making people's lives better across the world. Please check out our website to learn more and sign up. And as I mentioned, E4C's webinar series is part of our professional development offerings. And you can certainly find all of our archive videos and recorded presentations on our website, as well as on our YouTube channel. And again, I invite you to join us on Twitter if you are on Twitter. Now, E4C's next webinar will be in collaboration with the ASMEI show on the topic of intellectual property, what hardware innovators need to know. We will be joined by Dr. Isaac Rottenberg, Senior Director and Lecturer at the Center for Intellectual Property and Information Technology Law, or CIPIT, at Strathmore University in Nairobi, Kenya. This webinar will be on May 10th at 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. I invite you to check out our professional development page for registration details. If you're already an E4C member, we'll be sending you invitations to the webinar directly. Now, a few housekeeping items before we get started. I'd love to see where everyone is from today on the webinar. So, in the chat window, which is located to the bottom right of your screen, please type in your location. If the chat is not open on your screen, you can access it by clicking the chat icon in the top right corner of the screen. So, I'll get us all started here. I am dialing in from New York, and we have folks from Minnesota, from Tennessee, fantastic, Washington, California, Texas, Massachusetts, all over the United States. Very, very awesome. Welcome, everyone. We have some folks also answering in our Q&A, which is located immediately below the chat. This is a great opportunity to let you all know that the Q&A is where we would like you to actually ask your questions of the presenter so we can keep track of them. We would prefer that you use the chat in order to make any remarks or share any insights with the rest of the listeners. Although we welcome your comments here, let's keep those in the chat. I'll welcome everybody. Now, if you have any trouble with the audio broadcast and you need to fix that, please try hitting stop and then start. You may also want to try opening WebEx up in a different browser. Following the webinar, to request a certificate of completion showing one professional development hour for this session, please follow the instructions on top of the E4C professional development page, and the URL is listed. All right. Hey, welcome from Canada. I'm from Canada originally, so it's very exciting to have some Canadians on the line. All right. And with that, I'd like to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Stephen Harston. A little bit about Dr. Harston. He has a passion for helping others. After graduating from Brigham Young University, he has used his background in mechanical engineering, product design, and R&D to invent and design products that improve the lives of people in a developing world. Working closely with organizations such as the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, WHO, PATH, Global Good, and many others, he and his team at the Intellectual Ventures Lab have developed products that are helping save lives in Africa. One of Dr. Harston's products is he'll be talking about today is a passive vaccine storage device. And it's currently on display at the Bezos Center for Innovation at the Museum of History and Industry in Seattle. So I'm not going to go deeper, but you can learn all about Stephen Harston on our website and on Intellectual Ventures Lab, and he can tell you even more information about himself. So I turn it over to you, Stephen.
All right. Well, thank you very much. Let me get the presentation up and share my screen. All right. Well, it's great to be here today and talk with you guys about the design, testing, and implementation of a life-saving product in resource-constrained settings. I'm really excited to be here and share this with you guys. But let me start off by telling you a little bit about Intellectual Ventures Laboratory. At IVL, we invent to save lives. We are a specialized group of scientists, machinists, biologists, chemists, physicists, and engineers working together to address some of the most critical needs of those at the bottom of the economic pyramid. However, unlike some others who do similar things, we are a for-profit company, and so our approach to things might be slightly different than what you've seen before. While I will briefly mention the business side, I am primarily going to stick to the technical side of things in this presentation today. And let's start off by talking about how we invent. When we start a project, there usually is not a clear path forward. In fact, many times we don't even know what problem is that we're going to try and solve. And so we start our invention process by researching and collaborating with others. This, hopefully, will lead to the identification of some problems for which we will determine the return on investment. However, we determine ROI very differently than most companies. At the risk of oversimplifying things, we measure return on investment by how many lives we can save with the money we have available. If the market is being actively worked by universities and other companies, then it may not be the best market for us, not because we couldn't make money, but because our effort can likely be better spent elsewhere. Once we have decided that a problem is worthwhile to pursue, we begin by doing hand calculations, finite element analysis, computational fluid dynamics, modeling, and numerical optimization as we develop and refine the design. Along the path, we are constantly making prototypes in our machine shop, which I'll talk to in just a minute. As you know, this is obviously an iterative cycle until we end up with a fully functional product. At this point, it is our goal to partner with another company that has the skill set to finish taking the product to market in resource-constrained settings, thus allowing us to focus on the next project. That's a high-level view of our approach to invention, and now I would like to take a brief moment and share with you some of the cool projects that we are working on to get an even better idea of who we are. Probably my favorite project that we are working on is one called Photonic Fence, where we use lasers to shoot malaria-bearing mosquitoes out of the air. We do this with a system that can detect the shape, size, and airspeed of an insect to determine if it is a mosquito. Then the photonic fence will determine if the mosquito is male or female by measuring wing frequency, since it turns out that only the females bite humans. If the insect is a mosquito and if it is a female, then the photonic fence will shoot it out of the sky with a laser. I have a video here I'd like to show you guys of this. So we have, this is a series of pictures that we took of slow motion. We're shooting the laser at the mosquitoes, and it turns out that the exoskeleton of mosquitoes is quite difficult to penetrate. It takes quite a bit of energy. And so instead, what we're doing is we are burning the wings off of the mosquitoes, and that is enough to make it so that the mosquitoes cannot reproduce or bite humans. You can see how the wings literally vaporize into puffs of smoke. We have a working prototype of this here in the lab as well. It's pretty interesting to watch. So the goal of this project is to help protect vulnerable areas from malaria, such as hospitals, schools, etc. The photonic fence can also be reprogrammed to target other insects, such as those harmful to crops or even your common housefly. While shooting mosquitoes with lasers is pretty fun to watch, arguably we can have a bigger impact with our Institute for Disease Modeling, or IDM, which focuses on identifying the spread of diseases. IDM's numerical models receive inputs from a variety of sources to improve its accuracy, such as population density, travel patterns, roads, time of year, weather patterns, rainfall, standing water, migration of animals, historical spread of diseases, etc. We then take this data and run simulations on where would be the best place to deploy the 10,000 bed nets that we have available. Once we determine the best deployment strategy, we can inform local governments and NGOs how to be most effective with their resources. The same can be done for any disease, including malaria, tuberculosis, HIV, and others. In fact, IDM modeled and made recommendations during the recent Ebola outbreak on how to best achieve containment. This graphic that you see changing on the screen is an IDM model of the mosquito population as a function of time and other factors that we discussed previously. But we don't just work on the big and glamorous projects. This is a project that we worked on that is simply a milk jug that has been custom designed for the African dairy farmers based upon their direct feedback. This container minimizes the milk loss while milking cows and discourages the growth of harmful bacteria while being stored and transported. We have since partnered with Nestle to make a bigger impact with it in Africa. As is true for many resource-constrained settings, what appears to be a simple project frequently turns out to be a lot more involved and complex, even for something as simple as a milk jug. But the first problem I want to focus on today is establishing resource-constrained enabling resource-constrained locations to have constant access to vaccines. And as Jan was saying, according to the World Health Organization, 29% of all deaths in children between the ages of 1 and 5 are vaccine-preventable. And 1.5 million died from vaccine-preventable diseases in 2008 alone. As is evident from these stats, when vaccines aren't available, typically it is the children that suffer. We wanted to change this, and so we teamed up with the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, the World Health Organization, PATH, and Global Good to be sure that we understood the problem at hand and to address the real needs. However, the more we researched this issue, both through discussions here in Seattle and in visits to the developing countries, the more we discovered that the core of this problem was deceptively difficult. For example, if the vaccines freeze or get too warm, greater than 8 degrees Celsius, then they're rendered ineffective by WHO standards. What's worse is that it isn't always easy to determine when the vaccines have or have not spoiled. So it's possible that children are given vaccines without the required potency. When considering different types of solutions, a refrigerator could be used, but many resource-constrained settings either don't have power or have intermittent power. Even when there is a constant supply of vaccine, or excuse me, constant power supply, the locals have told me that the refrigerators typically only last a few years before they break, and there aren't any replacement parts available to replace them or repair them. Solutions that rely on solar power have also been used, but frequently the solar panels get repurposed or are not kept clean, which decreases efficiency. We thought about these issues and decided to try and come up with a completely passive device that would enable that would be able to maintain vaccines at the proper temperature for a month or more without access to any power. I have to admit, there were a few people that thought we were crazy, and heck, we thought we were a little crazy too, but we also decided to give it a try. So we decided to do some initial calculations and analysis, and it turns out that it is theoretically possible, and so we began to pursue our goal. When we started this project, we weren't experts in this field, and so we read the literature, talked to and hired experts, and gathered the right resources, one of which is our 11,000 square foot precision machine shop with dozens of machinists, all with the sole purpose of working with us to come up with a design. While our shop is not tailored for mass production, it is a custom-made prototyping shop with just about one of everything. This was an invaluable resource as it enabled us to make many prototypes and learn from our failures with quick turnaround times. After learning enough to understand the problem, we decided to settle on a design similar to a coffee thermos or liquid nitrogen dewars. While these devices work well for their applications, they have substantial limitations when trying to keep vaccines between 0 and 8 degrees Celsius for long periods of time. In fact, we initially purchased liquid nitrogen dewars, filled them with ice and vaccines, and measured how long they could keep vaccines cold. Within a matter of days, the ice had melted and the vaccines were too warm. And so we started making prototypes. Each of these prototypes taught us something new, taught us a new valuable lesson. For example, P1, which represents prototype one, with the array of sensors on top, demonstrated the initial proof of concept and technical feasibility. However, it was made of steel and quite heavy. P2 improved upon the design by being more strategic with the design of stress concentrations and attempted to use thinner materials that was heat treated to improve strength. However, our initial attempts at heat treatment caused the complete collapse of the device. P3 introduced an internal mechanism to dispense vaccines quite similar to a Coke or Pepsi vending machine. P4 was the first design made out of aluminum and was designed to have interchangeable parts and a removable top for testing. P5 was the first attempt at a final product, and P6 is the final instantiation of our vaccine storage device, which is optimized for minimal heat loss, weight reduction, and usability. One thing that is interesting to note is that our initial designs actually had longer hold times than our latest iteration. However, those designs were optimized for hold time and didn't consider field robustness, manufacturing cost, weight, etc. So while the final design may have less of a hold time than the other prototypes, it is well-rounded and is capable of meeting all of the product requirements. Now I want to ask you guys two questions and have you respond in the chat box. The first question is, if you were to go to the store and buy two 10-pound bags of ice, and put it in your camping cooler, how long do you think it would last before the ice melts? And the second question is, if I were to tell you that our device can hold ice substantially longer, how long would you guess our device can keep ice cold for? I'm going to minimize my screen for a minute so I can see some of the responses. Oh, I guess I have to stop sharing for a minute.
We have some folks answering in the Q&A, so I'll just read them out. 2 days, 3 hours. We have some folks saying 1 day to 2 weeks, and 18 hours, 12 to 24 hours or 3 weeks. And, of course, a good follow-up question, how hot is it outside?
Excellent question. let's say 43 degrees C or 110 degrees Fahrenheit.
Very hot. It's very, very, very hot outside.
And that's daytime temperatures, obviously, not nighttime temperatures.
All right, so we have more answers coming in here. 36 hours, 12 hours, 48 hours.
So if your camping cooler can only keep it cold for a couple hours to a couple days, best case scenario, our device is able to keep vaccines cold at 43 degrees Celsius, 110 degrees Fahrenheit, for 35 plus days in the African environment with vaccines constantly being accessed. Let me get back to my presentation. Oops. And this is what we end up right here. This is what we call the ARC tech. Interestingly enough, if you were to take the ARC tech and put it in our shop, which has an ambient temperature of 21 degrees Celsius or 70 degrees Fahrenheit, we were able to get greater than 60 days hold time, keeping the vaccines at the right temperature ranges. So the ARC tech combines the best attributes of vaccine cold boxes and stationary refrigerators currently used. Unlike other vaccine cold boxes where vaccines are kept cold from 1 to 5 days, our device holds temperatures for over a month, and unlike refrigerators, ARC tech is transportable, low cost, and low maintenance. And I also want to call out that there are no power sources. There's no solar panels, there's no battery, there's no electricity involved. It's simply ice, which 20 pounds of ice or 9 kilograms that keeps the vaccines cold for this time. So let's talk a little bit about how the ARC tech works. As you know, there are three types of heat transfer: convection, conduction, and radiation. Our goal is to minimize heat transfer in all three forms. To minimize convection, we keep the unit standing upright since cold air falls, and we keep a lid on the device as much as possible. Interestingly enough, the lid does not have a tight seal. We discovered that simply having something in the neck of the device, even if it doesn't seal tight around the edges, is sufficient to keep the cold air in. To also help minimize convection, we created a device that has an inner shell and an outer shell. Between these two shells, the space is leak tight and a vacuum is created. With the vacuum in this space, there are fewer molecules to transfer heat from the hot to the cold sides. To minimize conduction, we minimize contact between the cold inner shell and the hot outer shell, and we try to increase the path lengths as much as possible between the two. Can you guys see my mouse? Is my mouse visible?
Yes, it's visible.
Okay, great, thanks. So this right here is the bellows, and you can see how it weaves back and forth, and we do that to try to maximize the path length, as I was just talking about. So if frequently in thermal design, we do not worry about radiation, as it contributes significantly less than the other two forms of heat transfer. However, once we have reduced convection and conduction, radiation became the largest contributor. To address this issue, we used MLI, or multi-layer insulation, and placed it between the inner and outer shells of the device. An interesting fact, that the MLI that we use is the same material that is used on the space station and spaceships for radiation. Taking a closer look at the internal pieces, you can see how there are 8 half-moon ice blocks and 3 vaccine stacks. Each of the vaccine stacks may be reconfigured with different cups of varying sizes to accommodate different vaccine sizes, but in general, there is one large vaccine cup on the bottom, followed by 3 more vaccine cups secured on top. The nice thing is that the cups have an interlocking feature that allows you to quickly and easily detach and reattach the various cups and access the vaccines that you want. As I mentioned before, vaccines need to be kept between 0 and 8 degrees Celsius. But when you freeze ice, you typically get ice that is below 0 degrees Celsius. While it's fairly easy to raise the temperature of ice so that it's not below zero, we wanted to capture as much energy as possible from the ice. And another question that frequently pops up was, what type of ice do we use? This is just water ice. It's not dry ice or some other hybrid. It's simply ice that you get from your freezer at home. We wanted to know that instant it reached 0 degrees Celsius, the ice, and put it immediately into ARC tech. Again, a problem that sounds like it should be simple was not. For example, the existing protocol for ice blocks, as determined by the World Health Organization, is to put them out on a table spaced apart from each other and let them sit until they sweat or beads of water start to form on the ice blocks. But that's not very precise. We also looked at using a variety of timers and thermometers, but the variability of the ice was surprisingly high. Simply opening the freezer a few times had a notable impact on the ice temperatures, both for freezing and thawing. What we did learn, though, is that even if we put the ice blocks in at negative 1.5 C, the vaccines will not freeze in our device. And so we embedded into each of the ice blocks a thermometer, enabling the users to know when the ice has been properly conditioned. However, making changes to the ice conditioning protocol, defined by the World Health Organization, required some collaboration with the WHO. We also needed to go through a pre-qualification process as defined by the WHO. It turns out that in many countries, a device must be pre-qualified or else the product won't or can't be purchased. This was a great experience for us, and there were some valuable lessons learned. Specifically, by becoming an expert on the regulations enabled us to politely push back and influence changes in the regulations. In fact, after working with the WHO for a few iterations, they approached us and asked us to create a new category for ARC Tech in the PQS program. But we didn't just want to test the device thermally. We didn't want to just test it and have it perform well thermally. We wanted it to be robust as well. We wanted it to survive drops on the concrete. We wanted it to survive thousands of kilometers over bumpy roads, and we wanted to do it in such a way that we didn't require any replaceable parts. That is the reason for the foam bumpers on the top and bottom of ARC Tech. The foam bumpers are not for insulation, but to protect it when it gets dropped, tipped over, or when accidents happen. We've designed the ARC Tech to survive a half to a 1 meter drop on a concrete surface in any orientation. Think about it. What device do you own that you can drop on any edge from 1 meter onto concrete and have it be undamaged? Not your cell phone or your computer, not your microwave or dishwasher or refrigerator. With the exception of getting a supreme thermal performance, making this device robust was the hardest and most fun element of the project on the technical side. We started off by trying to figure out how to restrain the inner shell from bouncing around. The device needed to be stiff enough that when the device was laying on its side, the inner shell didn't touch the outer shell to minimize heat transfer. However, we couldn't put too much stress on the neck or else we could cause the device to buckle. Here you can see the most promising results of our brainstorming session for coming up with solutions to this problem. After doing some detailed finite element analysis on a number of the designs, we finally settled on this design seen here. We then did very extensive FEA in different orientations, but we didn't just trust our numerical results. We also took the device, instrumented it up with accelerometers, and dropped it dozens of times. Although nothing can replace testing it out in the field. Here we are in the middle of a field in one of our field trials, and we ended up burying our car up to the frame in this potato field. It literally took us hours and the help of many of the locals before we could finally get out of the car, get our car out. And believe it or not, we actually were following a road. While the thermal and structural performance is exciting, without ensuring that we are addressing the true need, all we have is an overly elaborate coffee thermos. This is why we're all about getting the real data. From working closely with the machinists during the design, to being involved with the end users to collect feedback. However, we can only be so many places at one time, and so we decided to put an electronics module on the field trial versions of ARC Tech. This electronics module is a completely standalone unit and measures internal and external temperature, alarms when the temperature is out of spec to reduce damage to the vaccines, alarms when the lid is open too long, logs GPS coordinates, and sends all of this data out via text message. This data we were able to collect live from the field was invaluable. We could see in real time if there was a problem, such as the lid being left open too long and the ice melting faster than it should, and immediately get a new load of ice sent out to the unit to prevent vaccines from spoiling. This further enables there to be a consistent supply of vaccines on hand at these remote villages. For example, here's a screenshot of some actual data we received during our field studies in Senegal. The arrows signify different units, and the colors signify the status of the units, such as if they are out of temperature spec, if the electronics are faulty, if the units need to be recharged with vaccines, etc. This data is then summarized for us so we can quickly and easily determine which units need attention. Not only did we get this data here in Seattle, but our partners in Senegal also had a direct access to this data to improve response times and identify issues. But we didn't just go and drop off the units and say, have fun. We spent a lot of time interacting with the locals and helped them understand why the units worked the way that they do and how to maximize performance. While we had to do the initial training, our strategy was to train the locals so that they became the resident experts. Our goal was to take ourselves out of the loop to more closely simulate reality. Now that the training is complete, we headed out to deploy the units. To ensure that we were truly addressing the problem, we did one field study in Ethiopia and two in Senegal with a total of 18 units. We openly admit that we don't have as good insight into the issues at hand as the locals do, so we sought out the local officials and nonprofits, such as PATH with Wheels on the Ground Support, to help select which health posts have the most need. The study was set up to simulate real use where each health post would receive a new supply of vaccines and ice on a monthly basis. We wanted to simulate reality as much as possible to determine where the problem areas were. With ARCTEC, we were looking for issues with usability, hold time, adequate vaccine capacity, etc. In addition, we were also looking for issues with ice and vaccine logistics, frequency of delays, spoilage of vaccines or ice, and overall complexity of the system. The data we collected from the 60 months worth of field data was invaluable, again, and the recommendations have been implemented into the final design. I just want to call your attention to this picture. This is quite typical of health posts that we visited. You can see that I'm using the flashlight on my phone just so that we can see enough to read and interact with the device, since the only source of light was a window and a door. Pay attention to the size of the health post. You can see the single bed on the right side and a counter on the left with the vaccine box sitting on it. This was the extent of the health post. The nurse in this particular health post was extremely grateful that her health post was chosen for the study, as her village was very far from the road, and they struggled to get vaccines and keep them cold. In the past, there were many times where vaccines were spoiled even before they reached her village. It was a true blessing to be able to be out there in person and see the gratitude that these people had for the effort that we were putting in their behalf. Each time I've been out in the field, it has been a humbling and extraordinary experience, and I sure can't wait to get back. It's great out there. But things don't always go as planned, and sometimes things break. However, this is arguably the most valuable thing that can happen. When things are going well, we don't learn nearly as much as when things go wrong. Here in this picture, I was working on some of the units, and some boys came up and were curious what the white boy was doing. At first, they were shy, but after a few minutes of sign language and encouragement, their curiosity won out, and they came over to help me out. Some other failures that we've had are loss of vacuum, poor bonding of joints, and thermal performance of some units. As we went about our root cause investigation process, there were many tools that we used and the results that we obtained. Here you can see a few, but my favorite is this one right here, when we took x-rays of the ARCTEC. I didn't even know that you could take x-rays through metal of this caliber. We even ended up blowing up and hanging some of these pictures on our walls at work as wall art. Arguably one of the most exciting parts about this entire project is when the field studies ended and we took our data from the field, our hand calculations, our high fidelity thermal models, and the test results that we did in the lab and compared them. We were very happy to see that the field performance of our units very closely matched that of our previous results. For the sake of brevity, I'm only going to show a few data points here, but you can see in this chart on the left, our actual units performance very closely matches the simulated performance. And in the plot on the right, you can see how well the units performed. On the horizontal axis, you have hold time in days, and on the vertical axis, you have internal temperature. The line between the red and the green blocks represents the 35-day mark, and this line up top represents 8 degrees Celsius. So this green portion right here, and anywhere to the right, is the part that we are interested in, as that results in a successful hold time. In parallel, our business side of the project was looking for a partner with a large-scale manufacturing capability to be able to work with us. We ended up partnering with ACMA, one of the world's largest manufacturers of refrigerators in the world. ACMA has vast experience with vacuum doers, similar to ARCTEC, as well as experience with distribution, sales, and other things needed in order to make a product successful. In addition to the success of our products, the ARCTEC has also been displayed at the Bezos Center for Innovation at the Museum of History in Seattle, as Yana said, and also featured on CNN, Wired Magazine, 60 Minutes, NPR, PBS, New York Times, and a number of other venues. One of the great things about having a product like ArcTech is that it tends to be repurposed for other worthwhile causes. For example, diseases like polio and Ebola have been eradicated in many countries through vaccination. However, they are still prominent in parts of the developing world. During the recent Ebola outbreak, the WHO approached us and asked with an urgent request to modify ArcTech to accommodate for the specific temperatures required for the new experimental Ebola vaccine. Instead of holding vaccines between 0 and 8C, we needed to modify ArcTech to hold vaccines between negative 80 to negative 60C. This required another series of design, testing, and modification to ArcTech, again, but we were able to meet the demands of the WHO and the CDC. ArcTech was then used to carry and distribute these life-saving vaccines throughout West Africa. While ArcTech has some great applications for resource-constrained settings, it also has some very interesting benefits to be used in the first-world applications. Consider transporting human organs. When somebody needs a heart or a kidney, the organs are frequently transported in camping coolers. While this works well for many applications, what happens when your truck or airplane breaks down? What happens when a winter storm or a hurricane blows in? With the current approach, they only have a maximum of 1 to 2 days before the ice melts. However, using the ArcTech, the risk of organ damage is significantly reduced. So I want to switch gears here and talk for a few minutes on another project that we are working on. However, I will have to apologize in advance for the lack of pictures. These next few projects that we are working on are, and I didn't want to forfeit our opportunity to patent these designs by presenting them prematurely here. That being said, let me provide some background. When I think of life-threatening illnesses, pneumonia is not high on my list. While it may not be a first-world issue, it turns out that 15% of all deaths in children under 5 is due to pneumonia, and this has been estimated to have killed 922,000 children in 2015 alone. One of the primary treatments of acute pneumonia is to provide the children with enriched oxygen from an oxygen concentrator, assuming the power is on. For this problem, we decided to put our initial focus on two areas, on locations that have power but may have frequent power outages. We are looking to address this problem from two different angles. The first angle is to redesign the mask that delivers oxygen to decrease oxygen loss, and two, to create a reservoir of oxygen that can be used during the times that the power is out. Let's start off by talking about the mask. To do our experiments, we used a child analog we named Omar, which means long life in Swahili, and the quick lung system to accurately simulate different breathing styles, including if a child is sick or not. We then could conduct experiments with different masks and see how efficient they deliver oxygen to the child. The idea is similar to a product that is currently on the market for adults called Oxymizer. Here you can see a plot with the oxygen flow rate on the horizontal axis in liters per minute and the percentage of oxygen in the space being measured on the vertical axis. You can see that the Oxymizer significantly outperforms a regular nose cannula. What we discovered is that the Oxymizer is highly dependent on the fit. If you have a poor fit with the nostrils, then the performance drops dramatically. But with our design, you can see how it not only outperforms the Oxymizer, but it also is much less influenced by the fit. Even a poor fit will still yield good results on a child wearing one of our masks. This is important because when the power goes out, there's only a very limited supply of oxygen, and so it is important to make it last. That being said, the second issue we are trying to address has to do with pediatric oxygen is creating a low-pressure reservoir of oxygen. Again, I can't show any pictures or discuss intricate details, but I can show some cool data. When the power goes out, the patients stop receiving a supply of oxygen. With our low-power reservoir attached, the patients can still receive a constant supply of oxygen even without power. This graph shows exactly that. On the horizontal axis, you have time in hours. The purple and green lines are associated with the left axis, and the right axis is associated with the blue line, which is percent oxygen. The tan sections denote the times when the power is out. You can see that we simulate a 30, 45, 60, and 90-minute power outages. The key is to look at the green line near the bottom of the graph and notice that it remains constant throughout all of the outages except for the 90-minute outage. This means that with our current system, for any given location that has less than 1 hour power outages, we can help maintain a constant supply of oxygen for these sick patients. Furthermore, if there are locations that need greater holdover time, we can easily modify our design to tailor the needs, to tailor to their needs. Well, I hope that you enjoyed this presentation as much as I've enjoyed giving it. I love being able to pass along the knowledge and information that I've gained. And if any of you are ever in the Seattle area, you should stop by my lab and come visit and come see some of the working prototypes that we have. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Steve. This has been inspirational and certainly insightful, and we're very thankful for you taking the time to share some of your lessons learned in doing this work. So at this point, I'd like to open it up for questions from our attendees. Oh, let me just get to the right slide here so that everybody can be sure to see that. Give us just a moment. All right. So we do have some questions that have already come in, so I'm just going to go ahead and move to them. The first is, can you tell us more about operating as a for-profit business in the development industry? For example, who do you sell your products to?
Yeah, so our business model is to partner with somebody and leverage that partner's experience to buy and sell products. So our tech in particular, there are a lot of applications where you can't make a ton of money in the developing world. That's everybody understands that. But there are also applications where you can make money. And so a lot of times what we do is we leverage our relationship with the partners and say we'll provide a discount rate of this technology if you guarantee to sell so many units in the developing countries. And then you can take whatever you want and sell it in the developing world. And so we encourage the partners to make money however they choose, with the minimum of understanding that they're going to sell at least a certain amount in the developing country, because that's where we really want the resources used.
Very cool. So another question related to your operation is, can you explain more about the relationship between global good and intellectual ventures?
Yeah, absolutely. So global good is essentially a spinoff of intellectual ventures, and it's similar to the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation in broad terms. That's probably the simplest way to describe it. But they do a lot of the background research, and they do a lot of interacting and collaboration to help define the problems. And the Intellectual Ventures Laboratory itself, so it's kind of three entities. You have Intellectual Ventures Laboratory, and then Global Good. And Global Good and the laboratory, we work very closely together to define these problems and select which ones we're going to advance.
Got you. All right, so we have a question that came in regarding the architect specifically, and you've already kind of spoken to it, but perhaps you could elaborate a little bit further. This listener wants to know if the architect is just for transport or storage only. So do you see other applications extending from delivering a vaccine and storing them?
Yeah, there's actually quite a number of applications in the biomedical industry in the developing world where our tech could be used. I'm not well versed in that area, so I can't really speak to it other than organ transport is the one that I'm primarily familiar with, and then vaccines in general. But I do know that there are locations even in the developing world where vaccines spoil, and vaccines are expensive. If I remember the number correctly, it was like $1 billion worth of vaccines spoiled last year. And
oh my
so
gosh.
And that's not just in the developing world, that's in the developed world as well. And so if we can do something to prevent that by having long-term storage options, that could be beneficial.
Absolutely. And you spoke during your presentation about regulation and the importance of understanding how to operate within regulatory frameworks and your relationship with the WHO. Can you expand a little bit on how long it took, if you can kind of give us a sense of the time invested in becoming, quote unquote, experts by WHO standards, and then also, you know, kind of becoming one of these, not only preferred, but accepted vendors or providers?
Yeah, so there's two elements to it. One is getting pre-qualified, and the other is developing the standards, the pre-qualification standards. And we spent a fair amount of time, probably 2 years studying and researching and going back and forth with the WHO, working on the standards with them before they approached us and said, okay, let's make a new category, the ARPTech category, essentially, because the ARPTech doesn't fit any existing category. And then after that, I think it took another 2 years just to get the qualification defined, and then it took some of the PQS qualification happened in parallel, so let's just say it took about a year to get it qualified.
Wow. So a substantial amount of time for anybody who's out there and thinking about how their particular innovation may actually go through the regulatory channels.
Yeah,
so we have another.
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. So we have another question that's come in that's very specific, technically relative to the ARPTech. So you spoke briefly and explained implementing a self-contained electronic temperature GPS and other sensing technologies to log data and monitor the device remotely. How long can the self-contained power source last before you need to be changed or recharge batteries, or I'm not sure how you are powering?
Yeah, so for the electronics module itself, it does have a small battery, and the sole purpose of that is just to power the electronics module, obviously. And that will last, it's designed to last at least a month. Realistically, it lasts, the design spec was 2 months, and it lasts closer to 3 or 4 months. But we have it set up so that we recharge it on a monthly basis as well. And we do that with just battery power packs that we bring out with the vaccines and the ice packs, vaccines and the ice.
Cool. All right. So we have a question going away from the ARPTech. Obviously, a lot of intrigue when you show mosquitoes being zapped by lasers. it makes you kind of almost want to do an Austin Powers impression, but I will refrain myself. So relative to the photonic fence, however, with, you know, the current threat of Zika and many other mosquito-borne diseases, there's actually quite a bit of interest. So this question is regarding your investment in the photonic fence. Is that something that you guys are going to pursue as a viable product, or are you pursuing it already? And if so, any idea when it might be ready for sale? When is it going to be ready for prime time?
Yeah, excellent questions. So I have to caveat this by saying I'm not on that team, and so I don't have the information of, like, when it's going to be ready for sale. I can say that, yes, we are advancing it. Yes, we're making excellent progress, but this is not an easy problem. If you start thinking about, like, the depth perception and optics and cost and power consumption and making it safe for humans and regulations involved because people are afraid of machines shooting lasers, and there's lots of things involved that's going to be a while before this is a viable product.
Yeah, I could imagine. So you mentioned that you are not on that team. So with your team, can you tell us a little bit more about the composition and size of the current team that is looking at both the ARPTech and the pneumonia devices?
Yeah, sure. So the teams in general are probably about 3 to 6 people, and that's not counting the machine shop. That's just counting our the engineers on the team that are doing the work. And then that ebbs and flows depending upon what the projects are. Like right now, ARPTech is just in the support phase. We're just supporting ACMA, and so we just have a single engineer. And when ACMA has any questions or concerns, we want to be there because we want the product to be successful. Like that's we're we're committed. We want to get out there and make an impact. And so it doesn't do us any good just to hand over the technology and say, here you go. We want to encourage success.
And is your team continuing to exclusively look at medical devices or the health arena, or are there other areas that you guys are currently kind of looking into?
No, in fact, the project I just completed was the artificial insemination of cattle and how to improve keeping bull semen cold longer. And that's it didn't fit well with the theme, so I didn't put it in here. But it's actually, we have quite a broad range of things that we're working on, as you saw just from the presentation today, and that's not even counting the non-biomedical elements.
Right. Well, I can only imagine the photographs you have for artificial insemination of cattle. all right. Well, with that, I'm going to see, are there any other questions that are out there from our listeners? I'm not seeing any additional inquiries, but if we haven't addressed them or you have a specific question for the speaker, then please do reach out via the email addresses on the slide. The slide deck will be at the discretion of the speaker to be shared. However, we will have a recording of the webinar that we will post on our site as well as on our YouTube channel in a few days. So look out for that. Thank you for asking that question. With that, I'd like to thank everybody for attending. I'd like to thank Steve for sharing some of these insights, these stories. It's been incredibly enlightening. And I would like to invite those of you who are seeking out professional development hours to do send us an email or do submit the form with the PEH code listed on the slide in order to receive your PEHs. And don't forget to become an E4C member to get information on our upcoming webinars and just to actually participate as a member of our community more actively. And with that, I'd like to thank everybody. Wish you all a good morning, good evening, or good afternoon, depending where you're joining us from today. And we'll catch you on the next Engineering for Change webinar. Thank you.
Thank you.